Thank you, everyone, for coming this morning. As I woke up at 6 o'clock this morning, it was a little early, I snuggled under the duvet and I heard that it was raining. And I'm sure some of you were in a similar situation. And I really felt warm and very comfortable. And I felt warm and comfortable because, frankly, the electricity was working. I don't have the heating on, but actually I had a roof over my head and everything was working in the house. I got up, I had a shower, it was hot. I went down to the kitchen, I flicked on the kettle, I made myself a cup of tea. And frankly, we do not, I think enough about what we take for granted around energy. Energy absolutely dominates us. It dominates us, and yet we all think of it as an extremely low interest category. We don't think about it at all. We don't until we flick the switch and it doesn't work. And so the impact on humanity of energy is, I think, absolutely fundamental, completely fundamental. And I'm extremely grateful to the panelists here today who are going to talk a bit about energy and talk a bit about campaigning in energy and how you bring energy to life through creativity. And just to give a little bit more color, Henrik Habberstad, Global Creative Director at Equinor. Henrik's organization provides 50% of the natural gas into the UK. So I have Henrik and his organization probably to thank for this morning. Ulrike Haugen, Chief Communications Officer at DNV GL. Ulrike's organization is around assurance and safety in the energy sector, the industrial sector, in the maritime sector, in different sectors. This is about making sure that our world is safe and ready to deliver energy and other big industrial services. So I was also thankful to the fact that Ulrike had provided services so that I could snuggle in my bed this morning. And Gavin Sheppard, Chief Marketing Officer of Smart Energy GB. Gavin is the voice of the UK's smart meter rollout. And in terms of modernizing our networks and our homes in the future, I can't think of anyone who is really more important in the country at the moment in terms of developing that. So just in terms of what we're going to do as a panel, I hope you're going to have some questions, because I'm certainly going to try and ask, and I may well point at one or two people who I know. But we're going to have a little introduction from each panel member, just for 3 or 4 minutes, just to give their perspective, and then we'll have 20 minutes or so of questions. So, Henrik, if I could ask you first, just to give a few impressions.
Just leave my glass over there. Thank you so much, Simon. Thank you, HNK. Thank you, WPP. Thank you, the National Gallery. Great to be here. This was the clicker. For those of you who are not that familiar with us, we are Equinor, formerly known as Statoil. Born and raised in Norway, but as you said, UK has been very important for us for decades. We have been supplying your gas since 1983. We are the largest oil supplier to the UK, and we are now leading a new offshore oil field called Mariner in the UK part of the North Sea. And 30 kilometers off the coast of Peterhead in Scotland, we are running the world's first floating wind farm, now also with battery storage called Batwin. Pretty cool name, huh? And with all our offshore UK wind farms, we are powering up to 650,000 homes. And as it said in the, and it says in the ad, we are heating and powering 8 million homes in the UK. So yes, UK is definitely important for us. But humanity, great topic, but also a big one. And I'm very glad that it's on the agenda, because as brand owners and marketeers, we have a role to play. We have responsibility. Energy is at the heart of everything. Energy is what makes the world goes around. Energy is also at the heart of many of the UN Sustainable Development Goals. Number 7 is about affordable and clean energy for all. Energy is, however, not only central to nearly every opportunity in the world, but also closely linked to nearly every major challenge. Climate change presents perhaps the most profound challenge in the world. It has an impact on all of us. In Norway, we witnessed the warmest summer in decades. Iceland, the wettest. We have seen tragic wildfires in Greece and in California. And public concern is also picking up all over the world. A poll presented in The Economist earlier this year concluded that 38 countries found that 61% of people see climate change as a big threat. Only the terrorists of Islamic State inspired more fear. So climate change is real, but at the same time, the world needs energy. So energy is central to nearly every major challenge and opportunity. That's the challenge. And it's definitely not an easy fix, but the world needs more sustainable energy. So where does brands and creativity come into the picture? A recent survey from McCann concluded that 81% of people believe that global brands have the power to make the world better. Think about that, 81%. And that also reminds me of Juan Noel Cafier's great definition of a brand. A brand is a name with the power to influence. And this is good news. We have the power to influence and make the world better. But to get people interested in what we have to say, we have to be creative. Creativity is the key to involve and engage people. It's about building perceptions and aspirations. So let's use creativity to attract great people that want to make a difference, that want to make the world a better place. The energy industry, more than ever before, need young minds with bold ideas. We need new partnerships. We need new collaborations. Let's use creativity to inspire our kids to get into science and STEM-related subjects. I think creativity is super important here. And for many years, Statoil's brand positioning statement was boldly searching for better. I think that's a great statement from an oil and gas company, but probably an even better statement for an energy company. And earlier this year, we took a big and bold move. We changed the name of the company from Statoil to Equinor. And that's because we are on a transition from a focused oil and gas company to a broad energy company. We changed the name, but we kept the positioning statement. And we kept it because we believe humanity needs an energy company that are boldly searching for better, more now than ever before. It's a big challenge, but we are ready. So let me end with the TVC that launched the Equinor brand in Norway in May this year.
This changed us. As did this. And this. Statoil was founded when Norway discovered oil in the North Sea 46 years ago. And since then, both we and our country have undergone great changes. That has demanded a lot from many, but also given us a lot in return. But some changes are so profound that they change everything. Changes that require us to find the balance between taking care of what we already have and investing in new beginnings. What we are and what we shall become. And now, as we transform from being an oil and gas company to a broad energy company, it's only natural that we also change our name. Anything else would be quite unlike Statoil. Equinor.
Thank you.
I'll start with the video.
Got a minute? We would like to discuss one of the biggest changes our planet is facing today, the transition to a cleaner energy future. Take a seat. Humanity is up against a tremendous challenge. The world population is set to reach 9 billion people in the decades ahead. We're going to need more cleaner energy than ever before. In the future, we expect electricity to be the largest energy carrier by using the power of the sun, wind, and water. but we've still got a long way to go. Unfortunately, there are no simple solutions. The global energy system is complex and interconnected. And to be sure to make the right decisions for our future, we need to understand the impact of the energy transition. DNV GL provides independent insights based on facts and data. Our global team of experts across every energy discipline is helping our customers speed up the energy transition. We're active around the globe, and our advice, tests, inspections, and certificates give customers the confidence to take the right decisions. We are taking responsibility for the future by supporting the energy sector and other industries in the transition. The time for action is now. The end result will be a planet that is safer, smarter, and greener for us and future generations. A cleaner electric future is within our reach, but only if we make the right choices today. So take a seat, let's talk.
Yes, thank you. You see, I don't click, no, I click too fast. Okay, what a great discussion. Thank you for inviting me to talk about energy, humanity, and creativity. That's the first time I combine all of those, actually. Yes, DNV GL is a company of technology experts in over 100 countries. As Simon introduced us and you saw in the video, 70% of our business is actually in the energy sector. And even though the video was now very much on the renewable side, but we've got big stakes on the maritime and traditional oil and gas side as well. So in a way for us to talk about energy is we're independent. We have a foot on both sides. So Equinor, of course, you're still a little bit more on the oil and gas side. So. But we feel we can be an independent advisor and trusted. Our vision is making an impact for a safe and sustainable world. And the strategic communication topics that we are focusing on is the decarbonization and digitalization, so very much on the energy transition. And to talk about how to talk energy and get it closer to humans, to people, we produce an annual report, the Energy Transition Outlook, that talks about a forecast of what the energy mix in 2050 is going to look like. And that's actually quite dramatic. And I think the messages, the content that comes out of that, telling people that we've got peak oil in 2023, that gas is taking over from 2026. And actually, at the moment, we've got 80% fossil fuels and 20% renewables. But in 2050, that will be a 50-50% share. So the transition is actually quite dramatic and will affect all of us. And even though this transition is very dramatic, we are not meeting the Paris Agreement goals. And talking about how we talk energy, how we include it in our communication and marketing activities, many of you know that 5 years ago, the United Nations launched those 17 Sustainable Development Goals, the SDGs, that Henrik mentioned already. The SDGs is something that we've used very much in the way we communicate. 5 years ago, we had in our group communications team a team that was the sustainability team. Well, from 5 years ago to now, it's really part of the DNA of all employees, and that team is almost not existent anymore because it's kind of totally integrated in the language of all employees. I think I'll stop here and we'll take the rest in the discussion. Yeah?
So I don't think you're going to find any of us denying the importance of energy or the challenges that it faces and that humanity faces in the context of energy. But I want to talk about how we engage consumers with the issue. And I thought I'd start with an ad.
When I fall in love, never fall in love. In a restless world like this is, love is ended before it's begun. And too many moonlight kisses seem to cool in the warmth of the sun.
It's easy to forget. Energy fills our lives with wonderful things. That's why we're proud to provide power to over 5 million UK homes and businesses to enjoy. We are SSE, and we're proud to make a difference.
So I think that ad is a wonderful portrayal of Simon's morning routine of waking up and being amazed by the energy that's all around us. And it's brilliant, isn't it? So it does all of these things for us, and it powers our lives, and it powers our homes, and it makes a difference to everything that we do. And we've got these wonderful energy companies who provide it for us, and we should be grateful that they pump this stuff into our homes and allow us to do all these wonderful, magical things with it. And that is true. The issue is, I don't think people feel it. I don't think people see it like that. And they certainly don't feel that in their relationship with their energy providers. I think they feel a bit more like this.
Hiya, sorry for the wait. Right, let's have a think.
We haven't scanned anything, have we?
Oh, no, we don't scan it in here. We estimate.
Estimate?
£48. Nope, scrap that. It's heavier than I thought. £78.
Can I your money, do you?
I want my items scanned. I want to pay the price and take them away.
That way madness lies. Do you know what I mean?
No, I don't. I think madness lies in your system.
Do you want him to make the sound?
Boop. OK, thanks very much. Happy to help.
And this is the issue, right? I think that that we've got this amazing, magical thing, and we don't value it, and we don't value our relationship with the people who provide it to us. In fact, we feel the opposite. It is low interest, and it's very, very low trust. And this isn't just about energy. The whole planet, we have this wonderful planet that we do not value and we do not take care of. So just because it's true doesn't mean that people feel it. And just because it is an existential threat to humanity doesn't mean that people will automatically act on it. Only around 40% of people trust their energy company, unless you've got a smart meter, in which case it's a bit more than 50% of people. But for something we all have to buy, only 40% of people trust it. And I think they don't understand their bills. There's a race to the bottom on price. The price is the only differentiator for people. And so where do you go? I think we need to do more as an industry to understand how people feel about energy, how people feel about the issues that affect energy, and about how it impacts their behaviour, and to acknowledge that and to be better at acknowledging it instead of painting a utopian world of energy magic, and to be more realistic in our view of how people feel about energy and the ways in which we engage them. Insight into how we want people to feel about energy, I don't think is insight. I think we mistake insight into how we want people to feel for how people do feel. And we need to understand their existing feelings in order to challenge those perceptions. And finally, I think we need to engage. Energy needs to engage with people's humanity if it wants people to engage with energy. And I think smart meters is one of the ways of doing this. It will provide a huge technological step forward. So if you don't care about your energy and it's only based on price, would you care about it if your energy provider could help spot whether an elderly relative was in the early stages of dementia, or whether they hadn't got out of bed that morning, or whether you'd left the hob on when you'd gone to work, or to settle an age-old family argument over whether cats need the light on at night in order to come in? These things can happen with technology, but energy has to engage with technology in order to engage with people's humanity.
So thank you all for that. I, a really interesting mix. But actually, if you look at it, apart from maybe some of the things Gavin put up later, quite a similar blend of we're all about the planet, we're all about saving things, and we're changing. There's a transition. So creativity presented in a certain way. And I wanted to ask the panel, you know, this group here is, many of them, struggling with creativity and introducing creativity into campaigns, into their brands. How do you start when it is such a low interest category? Where do you go in terms of starting the creative process in energy? How do you do that? Gavin, do you want to kick off on that?
I think you have to break it. I think you have to start by saying, what if we push this to an unacceptable point? And then maybe row slightly back from there. But I think with certainly in this country, with big legacy energy companies, I think the temptation is to creep forward rather than leap forward. So I think you've got to start by saying, what if we break this?
And how would you break it? Just give me an example of that.
So when we launched, in our experience, when we launched things like Gaz and Leckie, our campaign that personifies energy, and they're trying to kill each other as two cartoon characters, people said, you cannot do that. People will be terrified to switch on their lights because they think that, you know, somewhere there's a battle going on in their homes of energy. But you have to push that. You have to push that boundary. The supermarket stuff that we just did there, which is a real supermarket, one of our earliest ads, and probably our most effective piece of advertising. You know, at the time, people went, you can't, within the industry, energy industry, who now like it, but at the time started with, but you can't do that. You can't point out to consumers that this is broken because they won't trust us. But I think, it is a truth. You know, the lack of trust and the lack of interest in the energy category is a truth. If we don't acknowledge that, then I think we compound the trust problem, not deal with it.
I mean, Henrik, for Equinor, of course, a much more focused B2B business, but actually impacting on campaigns, on consumers, and needing to get that trust. In terms of the creative process as global creative director, establishing a new brand, where do you start? Do you agree with break it up, or how do you go on that?
I think that's a good approach. I mean, in Norway, I think it's fair to say that, yes, we are a B2B company, but we also be to human company in Norway, because we are own 67% of the Norwegian population, right? So I think that's important to take that approach. But I think for us it's very important to start also in Norway, that one size doesn't fit all. So using the data and all the insight, what do we do, how do we talk to the high interest consumers, and how do we talk to the low interest? Because if you're starting to talk about the biggest transition in modern energy system ever is on in the way, we will lose a lot of people in Norway. So breaking it up a little bit, high interest, you can be a bit more advanced in the approach, but to the low interest, straight to the point. So when we're launching a new name, we're not telling the story about the broad energy company. Then it's oil, gas, wind and sun, Equinor, period. So breaking it up. I think that's
okay,
important.
So you're a breakup person as well. Ulrike, I mean, you have a slightly different role in that, you know, your company is not well known by consumers at all. In fact, you don't really look at the consumer market at all. You look into business and you really try to sell in there. I mean, your types of communication are therefore going to be a little bit more traditional in that sense. Are you a break it up person in terms of starting the creative process? Does that work for you? Or do you come at it from a slightly different angle?
Yeah, no, we do break up. I mean, just in terms of how we set it up, a campaign like this Green Chair campaign, for instance, you know, we start with Google sprints now these days. So the teams are very excited about that methodology of developing new campaigns, new things. Content is very important for us because, as you say, our target audience is not necessarily the end consumer. So it's a B2B combination, B2B communication. But if we have a look at, for instance, the Edelman Trust Barometer, who are the most kind of trusted in times of fake news, for instance, and that's experts. And we're a company of 12,500 experts. So that was like a thumbs up, great, you know, we've got it. We've got content, but how do we bring that content closer to
to the people. And in the screen chair, for instance, the campaign, we said we'll break it up. So this one, for instance, was more related to the renewables, but we make it more tangible and put our experts in the chair. They tell their stories. So the storytelling to bring energy close to people in their role as, you know, a business person, but also in their private life, I think is important.
So you're appealing to the human side of it as well.
Yes.
And I think that's really where everyone will get to in this. But in terms of breaking things up, Gavin, you have a very specific style of trying to get into consumers. Do you think it's are you trying to shock people into it? Are you trying to get through to improve trust and get out of a low interest category through shock? Or what do you do after breakup? How do you rebuild?
I don't think it's necessarily about shock. I think it's about holding a mirror to people. So Karen said something first thing, that people have to see something that they recognize of themselves in advertising. I would suggest that not many people think about energy in the way in which you did this morning. And perhaps you wouldn't have thought about it like that if you hadn't been coming to chair this panel. And so if you present that to people and they can't see anything within that they recognize, then I think you've sort of lost that first off, because people are going, well, I don't recognise, it's not how I feel about life. I think it's crap, you know, and so you've got to start there. So don't think it's about shock, I think it's about realism. Beyond that, I think you have to show people the problem and then you have to show people the solutions. So what's interesting about estimation for us as being accurate bills is one of the, and seeing what you're using in pounds and pence, these things are sort of part of the core benefit of smart meters. But when you start by saying to people, what do you think about estimated bills, they sort of go, well, yeah, actually, I find it really, really annoying, it really worries me, and it causes me massive stress because I don't know what my next energy bill is going to be. And you say, well, what do you want to do about it? And people sort of go, well, there's nothing you can do about it, really. It's like the fact that it rains occasionally. It's just, it's crap, and that's how it is. And so people are sort of conditioned to accept it. So you have to agitate a bit and poke and go, but that's not right. We wouldn't put up with that anywhere else. Once you've set up the problem, you can then say there's a solution to the problem. But realism in the problem, I think, is key.
I mean, do you think, Henrik, that there is a lot of adverse opinion about the energy mix, about the energy markets, about the planet and the way that companies have affected the planet over many, many years? I mean, do you think sometimes that some people might think that creativity is a little bit flippant in terms of the energy sector? Do you think that creativity is the right way to be trying to win the argument?
I think that depends on how you define creativity. Because creativity to me is about telling a story or presenting facts in a way that people are interested in listening to. So creativity to me is not about being crazy. Or just entertainment. It's about presenting the fact and an opinion in a new way. And I also like the problem versus solution thing you're saying there, Gavin, because I think for many years the energy industry has said that we are part of the solution. We are part of the climate solution. But we have not been good enough to acknowledging that we are actually part of the problem. So I think you need, in order to establish trust, you need to start with that. Because then I think people are more interested in listening to what we're you have to say. And that to me is also about how do you explain that in an interesting way. And again, that is creativity, I think. Yeah. The relevance is absolutely key. I know it's a cliche to say that, but it's key.
Yeah. Absolutely. This is the difference between creativity and fantasy. You know, we're not making feature films, right. We're making ads. And the point I made there, creativity without insight is just fantasy. And relevance and insight has to drive the creativity. Otherwise it lands with no one.
Mm. Ulrike, where do you stand on this issue around creativity being maybe the wrong way to go in terms of it maybe being a little bit flippant in terms of the responsibility of the energy sector? Mm.
Well, I also think that it depends on how you define creativity. I think creativity, in the way I understand it for our business, is very much about telling the story in a creative way so that the recipient of that message can take the right decisions. So for us, it is that we get across enough data in an easy way so that the ship owners can order ships that can still run in 2050 in an energy efficient way. We communicate a lot about energy efficiency and to make people understand what energy efficiency is about. Something else I wanted to mention in that sense as well, when we talk about creativity and telling the story, is that we need to encourage a debate in the public. I had great meetings with Equinor last week, actually, talking about that we need to talk about carbon capture and storage, about a carbon price. We, as an independent company, don't want to take a political position, but we want to provide enough insights so that the politicians can take the right decisions.
I was very interested in your report that you you launched this week, your new energy transition outlook, and there was a lot of discussion about lots of statistics and various things in there. But actually, it's a forecast, and you're one of the only organisations out there that doesn't just provide scenarios for the future, but actually puts a forecast out there. And your forecast was unbelievably damning in that it's not going to hit the Paris goals at all. And in fact, climate change is happening much, much more rapidly. You launched that report, and not a single person really is outraged about that. And we talk about humanity. I just wonder whether you reflect on, is there a creative way to bring this climate change debate to life in a way that's really, really going to affect people and change behaviour?
Well, I think by putting out that data and actually saying we're not going to meet the Paris Agreement goal, so we will have a global warming of 2.6 degrees or more, it encourages a discussion on what you and I, the industry, needs to do in order to try to manage those 2 degrees.
Henrik, do you have a reflection on the Paris goals? You've talked about responsibility and being part of, acknowledging part of the problem and part of the solution, but is there a way to get this debate much, much more focused?
I think the debate and dialogue is probably a very good thing. Not only discuss and have a dialogue with an expert, but opening more up also for the more public. A couple of years ago, we had a project called Great Ideas from Young Minds, inspiring more young people into the dialogue. Not only present all the data and facts, but actually discussing it and get their ideas and inputs. I think dialogue is also very, very important. Because I think that what we tend to do is to say, okay, you don't know enough about the climate change and the importance of this industry, and then we're throwing more facts at you. But how do we make that facts available, and how do we open up for more ideas from outside? And someone said, the word tone of voice we used earlier today. I think tone of voice is super important. And for us, moving from Stotter to Equinor, a new tone of voice, which is more open, more human, and more dialogue-oriented, is very important. So I think that is one of the keys, maybe.
And maybe on the tone of voice, interesting. I attended one of the biggest oil and gas conferences a couple of weeks ago, and of course you need to have a front runner, and Equinor definitely is a front runner. But it was interesting to see, the whole industry is changing their tone of voice. Nobody dared to actually talk about oil and gas, and it's definitely not about oil. Everybody was trying to talk about clean energy and they're, in the transition, and that's the way of being hip. It's a change of language, and that's a part of creativity as well.
Yeah. And Gavin, I'm not going to ask you about the Paris Agreement and your views on that, but I think you do have an exceptionally important position in the energy market in terms of, modernising the country and modernising the home. And I wondered whether you just had a final reflection on creativity around modernizing and moving beyond old networks.
On the broader point, I think, of climate change, all of our research shows that where you have, when you land a message about the broader issue of climate change or reducing energy consumption and what we need to do as a nation, and you land that in concert with a personal benefit, then it has an accelerant effect. So I think that broader message is important. to people, but I agree that we're probably not doing as well as we can in landing it. In terms of modernising the home, I think, you know, you have to, the thing about smart, which has its greatest potential, I think, is that it allows energy reduction to happen in a way which brings great personal benefit. And so therefore sort of automates the change in behaviour that you want to see. And I think those sorts of technologies, and hopefully over the next 10 years, we'll see all sorts of technologies, and we won't be talking about smart meters. But they'll all be based on a smart grid, and they'll all be based on having this thing in your home that actually knows when you're using it and when energy is most available. And I can't see without that sort of innovation how any technology is going to solve this problem.
Well, I'm being given the eye by Jess, who wants to move the discussion over. So I'm sorry if there are questions from the audience, but the panelists will be available over lunch. But if you could thank them for me, thank you very much.
Thank you, Simon, and thank you to our panel.